joke.
Lord be with you. Today in our gospel lesson, Jesus heals Peter's mother-in-law of a fever and restores her then to a valuable place in society. We will look at today healing and difference. That's actually an anthropological difference in studying ancient literature. Healing, or in a cure. In case you are interested. We also today receive new members. And it's also, I see Nathan's here. Is today Boy Scout Sunday? Did we put that in the bulletin for today? There's been confusion. Oh. Okay. Today is the official. So Nathan is official. But next week we'll have more scouts here in uniforms. Nathan, wear your uniform again next week. Let's prepare our hearts for worship. Are we going to have an opening song?
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, you sent your only begotten Son to be with us, to heal us. He went about the countryside, healing all in need. Let us do the same in your name. Let us be healers to the people of your kingdom. Everlasting God, you give strength to the weak and power to the faint. Make us agents of your healing and wholeness, that your good news may be made known to the ends of your creation. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Today we gather to hear the Word of God, pray for healing of every kind, spiritual, physical, and emotional, and ask God's blessing for health and wholeness through Christ our Lord. Let us pray. Great God, our healer, by your power, the Lord Jesus healed and gave hope. As we gather in his name, look upon us with mercy and bless us with your healing spirit. Bring us comfort in the midst of pain, strength to transform our weakness, and light to illuminate our darkness. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our crucified and risen Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And we do pray that God will send his healing grace to all who are sick, injured, or disabled, that they may be made whole. We pray that God would mend broken relationships, restore those in emotional distress to soundness of mind and serenity of spirit. We pray that God would restore to wholeness whatever is broken in our lives. So, brothers and sisters, I invite you to come and receive a sign of healing and wholeness in the name of our triune God. And when you come forward and kneel, if you would give your name to the ministers who will be anointing you and having a prayer of healing over you, because they don't know everybody's name. You may be seated.
Thank you. chasing what's missing, but then empty inside. It just ain't gonna listen when nothing can satisfy. And the world leaves you high and dry. Just come to the well.
Oh,
please rise and receive this blessing. Almighty God, who is a strong tower to all, to whom all things in heaven and on earth bow and obey, be now and evermore your sure defense, and help you to know that the name given to us for health and salvation is the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Our gospel lesson this morning is found in the first chapter of the Gospel of Mark. As soon as they, the disciples and Jesus, left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. He came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. Then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sundown, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons, and the whole city was gathered around the door. And he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons, and he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up and went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." He answered, "Let us go on to the neighboring towns so that I may proclaim the message there also. For that is what I came out to do." And he went throughout Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. The Gospel of the Lord. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Share God's peace by greeting those around you. All right, I would like to invite the young people to come forward. Good morning. Anybody know what this is? Well, it's a what? It's a plugger? Is that a cross between a plug and a charger? This is a battery charger. How many of you have those at home?
I don't. I do.
I bet you if your parents... I bet you if your parents have cell phones, don't they have chargers?
Yes.
Audrey, do you think you have one of these at home?
No.
We have all kinds of batteries that are low on juice. They need to be recharged.
What and if an elephant stomps on the whole wide world?
If an elephant was big enough to stomp on the whole wide world, we would be in trouble. That might be the end of the world, okay? All right. When a battery needs to be recharged, we put it in here, and it recharges. It says it will charge it, it will refresh it, it'll even analyze it.
What is analyzing?
Find out what's wrong. Now, what do you do? Do you ever feel like you need to be recharged? Taking a nap is a good idea when you need to be recharged. You'd like to have a movie night. That might recharge you. Here's what Jesus did. When he needed to be recharged, and we heard about that in the gospel lesson I read, with a fruit ball, is that what you said? Okay. Here's what Jesus did. He would go, and he had a busy day. He preached and he healed all kinds of people. And he was just worn out. And what he did was, in the morning, the next day in the morning, early, he went and found a quiet place. Do you know what he did there?
He rested.
He prayed. He prayed. And by praying, he felt himself recharged. Very often when we come to church on Sunday, we come to get recharged. We hear the gospel. We hear the good news. We hear that God loves and cares for us. We hear the words of forgiveness. All kinds of things that give us a recharge. And it's good for us to find times during the day, sometimes that's best, to pray and recharge. What about eating? It's always good to have a good balanced diet. Let us pray. Repeat after me. Gracious God, we thank you for Jesus. We thank you that he healed. We thank you that he found time to be with you. Help us to find time to recharge. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, you can go back to your seats. You'll be pleased to know I cut down my sermon by 2/3 from last night. I'm going to see if this works today. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Today we're going to talk about curing and healing disease and illness. Anthropologists, in looking at ancient texts, have tried to look at things and determine, and they've made an understanding. They have an understanding that there's a difference between curing and healing. Curing is when, and curing has to do with helping somebody with a disease, someone who has a biomedical problem, a condition that needs to be cured of. Healing is broader than that. It's restoring someone to a valued place in society where they feel valued. Disease, a biomedical malfunction, hearing is aimed at disease. Well, let me lengthen my sermon a little bit. Let me give you a story of someone who was healed. At least she claimed to be healed. Does anybody remember Dean Jones, the movie actor? He was in those slug bug movies back in the 60s. He and his wife went to Mexico on a tour, and they were in Mexico City, and they were touring all the tourist spots in Mexico City, and one of them was the cathedral. And he was there making snide remarks about it, like, boy, this place has to be a bugger to heat, and things like that. But when they came to the end of the tour, their tour guide said, if you would like, now is the time to pray. And he's thinking, well, maybe we'll go and wait out by the bus. But his wife, Lori, said to him, I'd like to pray. So he went with her, and she kneeled and was praying. And she prayed that her arthritis would go away. She had been taking 30 aspirin tablets a day. I guess in the 1960s, they didn't know how bad they were for your stomach. 30 a day. And every time she moved her fingers, she did so in great pain. And she got up, and as they were walking out, she said to Dean, I think something happened to me. I don't know. The next day, she started taking fewer aspirin. The next day, fewer. The third day, she was off aspirin completely and never felt pain, arthritic pain anymore. Now, was her condition psychological, or did she actually receive a cure for a biomedical malfunction? Cure. Well, our gospel text today shows Jesus curing. He goes to Simon Peter's house, and there his mother-in-law is sick in bed. She has a fever. Many who are trying to diagnose that illness through over the centuries and over a few words feel that this was probably a fever that was fatal. And Jesus, when hearing about it, went into her room. And something that was unheard of, a male who she was not familiar with, was not related to, goes and takes her by the hand, touched her. Not only that, with this illness, it was going to make Jesus ceremonially unclean. So it was something that a rabbi, a teacher would not do. But he took her by the hand, and it says he lifted her up, and she was cured. No more fever. And then what happened? Everyone makes fun of this, or at least some people do. She was healed, and she immediately started serving supper. You notice the book? Being dead is no excuse. The official Southern lady's guide to hosting the perfect funeral. I thought that fit. She was cured of her illness. Cured of her disease, excuse me. And now she was healed because she could now take her place as a valued member of their society. People would be amazed. Oh, now she can show her proper place as the one who is in charge with hospitality in this house. That was healing. Let me give you an example of this in this cartoon, for better or for worse. Here, this is Ellie's parents. And her mother has just returned from the hospital, having had surgery. And her husband says, little April, Ellie, and Phil are going home tomorrow. And Ellie's mother says, I know, we'll miss them. It was good they came. I have to tell you, Marion, when you had your surgery, I was terrified. I don't know what I'd do without you. And Marion's about to tell him, you had smoked too much, wash your clothes too little, and never eat your vegetables. I'm so glad you came back. And Miriam says, I'm so glad you still need me. See, she's restored. She was cured at the hospital. Whatever they had to cut out, they cut out. She was cured at the hospital, but she was healed when she was able to be restored to a valued place in society. Big difference. Let's see what I have on next. So Peter's mother-in-law could take her valued place, showing hospitality. The men's Bible study this week, we were talking about this concept, and David Seward said, a daughter of my cousin. He said, an interesting thing happened. He said, I only learned about this recently because she had died, but a daughter of his cousin had, because of an accident of birth, oxygen deprivation during birth, she wound up having to live her life in a wheelchair, had difficult time communicating to people, could communicate very well with her parents, but they all worked very hard, and she lived quite a normal life. If you call getting married a normal life. And then some people from church said, oh, we're going to have a healing service. We want you to come. And she said, why? And they said, don't you want to be cured? Don't you want to get out of that chair and be normal? And her response was, well, I am normal. Why? She felt her life was of value. And she even said this. Now, I question this theology. I'm not suggesting the theology is good. But she said, God made me this way. I don't need to be cured. She had already felt as if she were healed. What does that mean for us? We're not always good about curing people. We pray to have people cured, and I'll tell you, I've said this in the past, to actually be healed, to be cured, is rare. But what we are good at is helping people be healed, to be whole again, to find a place of value in society. Past couple of weeks, I've been pestered by one of our little people in the congregation. He's been very concerned. I love being pestered by him, by the way. Very concerned about Officer Pearson, shot in the head in the line of duty. Pastor Dan, let's get him in the prayers. I said, yes, I'll do that. Then he came to me yesterday and said, Pastor Dan, we need to raise some money for him. In fact, he said, I need to raise some money for him. And I said, oh, okay. But I said, let me explain how we do things. First off, tell me what you want to do. And we wrote down, raise some money, have a bake sale, take a collection for Officer Pearson. And then I said, how does this help us fulfill our mission? So we went through the mission statement and we came to offer healing and care to all in need. I said, okay, it'll help us fulfill our mission. And then I said to him, what resources do we need? And I said, you'll be more successful if we can do this with more people. And he said, oh. And I said, how about you ask the Sunday school if they would like to help? Don't you think that would be great? Especially if you're going to have a bake sale. Mom is going to be mighty busy, right? Let's get the Sunday school involved. Oh, okay, we'll do that. And then I said, who's going to be accountable? Who can I hold accountable to make sure this gets done? Of course, I'll hold him accountable. Maybe his mom. The whole point is, we can work toward Officer Pearson's healing. He's being made whole, being made a person of value in society. Our contribution would be small compared to everything else in our community that needs to be done. We can continue to pray that he be cured. But our job also is to be made to make sure he's made whole, healed. So today, I'm very thankful that Jesus can cure diseases. Notice he didn't cure everyone. In fact, he left Peter's home and family and went off and worked with other people. But he makes us a community of grace, mercy, and love to help make people whole again, healed. Amen.
Please rise and sing as we share our tithes and offerings.
Savior's love through the storm.
God. We pray that you deepen our commitment and that of all Christians to proclaim the gospel. Like Jesus, we want many to hear, respond, and share in the blessings of your kingdom. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious God, you are a global God. Today we pray for our brothers and sisters in our that our synod has a relationship with Lutheran Christians in Asia, Russia, as they rebuild and renew the church after decades of oppression. Pour out your spirit upon Bishop Scaldi, Dean Brockman, Pastors Alexander and Glebe, Missionary Braden, and all of the faithful people of Russia who gather for worship and reach out with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Strengthen our partnership with them in our common mission. Lord, in your mercy. Everlasting God, you rule over the nations and guide their paths toward the fulfillment of your purpose, your peace, your justice. Our hearts ache as we hear of the Islamic State forces burning alive a captive Jordanian pilot, and they're reporting the death of a relief worker. We ache as the United Nations reports that Iraqi children are becoming victims of systemic sexual abuse in areas controlled by the Islamic State. As fighting escalates in Ukraine, we pray that you send your peace. Lord, in your mercy. God of healing, give strength to the powerless. Heal the sick. Relieve the pain of those who suffer, especially of Marilyn Boston, Pamela Cinquini, Kelly Caldwell, Mickey Fuller, the family of Kale Fuller, Tiffany Giles, Randy Greenwood, Maynard Hansen, Dustin Jones, Jim Lampy, Pat Morrison, Margaret Peterson, Officer Pearson, Jan Snath, Louise Snyder, Wayne Sproul, Mary Thomas, Cynthia Tulin, Janice Trotter, Joe West, and Ed Wood. Are there any others? Unsearchable God, guide us to follow in faith where the saints have led until we join them at your throne. We pray that you comfort those who mourn, especially the family and friends of Solomon Snyder and of Eva Dial. Lord, in your mercy. And gracious Heavenly Father, we do pray that you bless our scouts. Bless both the adults who sacrifice so much to lead, as well as the young people as they are led. Help them to grow and mature. Lord, in your mercy.
When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless stand before the throne. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, he is Lord, Lord of all.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Blessed are you, O holy God, you are the life and light of all. Blessed are you for Jesus, your Son. He is your light shining in our darkness and revealing to us your mercy and might. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." then after supper he took the cup, gave thanks, gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his preaching and healing, his dying and rising, and his promise to come again, we await that day when all the universe will rejoice in your holy and life-giving light. By your Spirit, bless us and this meal, that refreshed with this heavenly food, we may be light for the world, revealing the brilliance of your Son who taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. The second Sunday of the month, we commune via intinction, where you will receive the bread or a wafer in your hand, hold on to it until the chalice comes by and dip or intinct it into the chalice. The second oldest known form of communion in history. All is ready. Our Lord invites us. Please come.
Saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed. Good to me, his word my hope. bear to shine. But God, who called me here below, will be forever mine. Will be forever mine. You are.
Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, through the gifts of his body and blood, strengthen, keep, and unite us now and forever. Amen. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this gift of life. We pray that as you heal us and make us whole, help us to leave this place to bring that healing and wholeness to all we meet. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'm going to invite you to be seated for a moment. And new members can come forward. Kyle's going to be brave. We had about 8 at the early service. In fact, Kyle, I'm going to have you stand here so everyone can see your smiling face. Everyone who's a member of Messiah Lutheran Church, we say the mission statement at the end of our worship service. It's written in our windows in that wavy line. And we ask new members, and as we all should be reminded, to participate somehow in each one of those ways as part of the mission of the church. We've said that, and this is the official statement, Kyle, that you either say yes or no to. We do welcome you as a member of Messiah Lutheran Church, and we ask that you join with us in worshiping God, hearing God's word and sharing his supper, proclaiming the good news of God in Christ through word and deed, serving all people, and striving for justice and peace in all the earth. And if you're willing to do that, just say, I do. I don't know what I'd do if he said, I won't. But let us pray. We thank you, Lord, for Kyle, a new member of our congregation. By your life-giving power, bind us to each other in you. Strengthen us for service. Support us all our days, and bring us at length to that day when all your children will be one, and you will be all in all. Amen. And now, we welcome you, Kyle. Receive this benediction. Please rise. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the grace that sustains every breath we take, the love of God that gives us courage and strength, and the abiding presence of the Holy Spirit that fills our hearts with comfort and peace, be with you and all those you care about, now and forever. Amen.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises.
You came from heaven.